Before we start our service, I just want to read a letter that we received from our Holy Father. His Eminence Cardinal Christophe Pierre, who is the Apostolic Nuncio, the Vatican Ambassador to the United States, forwarded it to me earlier this week. It's addressed to me and to the people of St. Anne's. I was pleased to be informed that the National Shrine Basilica of St. Anne is celebrating the 100th anniversary of its solemn novena to its holy patroness, and I send my prayerful best wishes to all those participating. I also join you in giving thanks for the many graces received by countless numbers of pilgrims from the Diocese of Scranton and beyond who have come to this venerable place over the past 10 decades to invoke the intercession of her who is the mother of the Blessed Virgin Mary and the grandmother of Jesus. In this regard, there are three central themes that merit reflection on such an important occasion: prayer, pilgrimage, and the Eucharist. Through time spent in prayer, we enter into a relationship with God who has known and loved us first. It is our response to the Lord and to his invitation to come to know him and be accompanied by him throughout our lives, to come and see who he is and to stay with him. Prayer is like a cry that issues from the heart of those who trust themselves to God. But it is also a dialogue with him. In every part of our lives, including our joys, trials, hopes, and dreams, should be brought to the Lord with confidence. It also gives us the grace to go out joyfully to the peripheries and to share the closeness, compassion, and tender love of Jesus with those most in need. A particular form of prayer with ancient origins is the practice of making a pilgrimage to holy sites, which is one of the people of God's most eloquent expressions of faith. A shrine such as yours is truly a privileged place to meet the Lord and to experience his love and mercy, especially in the sacrament of confession. Often a journey of faith of this kind allows us to leave behind the noise and the anxieties of daily life, even if only briefly, to focus on the thing necessary, namely our relationship with Jesus and the grace and joy which it brings. Our prayer and any pilgrimage should ultimately focus us on the Eucharist, the source and the summit of the Christian life. In receiving the Lord in Holy Communion, we draw strength to live out our faith, especially to be missionary disciples who desire to spread the gospel in the world. Through the National Eucharistic Revival, the Church in the United States has been called to promote a renewal of love and devotion for this wonderful sacrament, in which we encounter the true sweetness of Jesus' love for us through his real presence among us under the humble forms of bread and wine. May it also lead us to rediscovery of the most important practice of Eucharistic adoration, where we silently remain in the presence of the one who loves us. With these sentiments, I entrust you, the members of the Passionist community, the diocesan priests who assist with the sacramental ministry for pilgrims, and all those who participate in this novena, to the loving intercession of St. Anne and the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of the Church, and I gladly impart my papal blessing as a pledge of wisdom, joy, and peace in the Lord. Given in Rome, Francis, Pope of the Church. So there we are. We are joined today in a special way with Pope Francis, asking us to deepen our love for Jesus through the instruments of his grandmother. So may every blessing that our Holy Father sends be yours and your families as we celebrate St. Anne's Feast Day. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, incline unto my aid, O God. Let us pray. Almighty God, Father of mercies and giver of all good gifts, we kneel before you to honor you and your saints and to seek their intercession in our many needs. We are truly sorry for all our sins and humbly ask your pardon. Please grant our requests and in full measure of the indulgences granted by your vicar, the Pope, and draw us ever nearer your divine heart. Amen. Prayer to St. Anne, Mother of the Blessed Virgin Mary. With a heart full of sincere and filial veneration, I prostrate myself before you, O blessed St. Anne. You are that beloved and privileged creature who, because of your extraordinary virtue and sanctity, did deserve of God that chief of graces of giving life to the treasury of grace, the blessed among women, the mother of the incarnate Lord, the Blessed Virgin Mary. Ah, in consideration of such exalted favors, please, O most tender saint, receive me among the number of your truly devoted servants, for such I profess myself to be and wish to remain for the rest of my life. Surround me with your efficacious patronage and obtain for me from God the imitation of those virtues with which you were so profusely adorned. Obtain for me the knowledge of my sins and sorrow for them, an ardent love of Jesus and Mary, and a faithful and constant observance of the duties of my state in life. Save me from all dangers in life, and assist me at the hour of my death, that I may safely reach paradise, there to praise with you, most happy mother, the word of God made man in the womb of your most pure daughter, the Blessed Virgin Mary. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, never shall be, world without end. Amen. Prayer to St. Anne to obtain a special favor. O glorious St. Anne, filled with compassion for those who invoke you, and with love for those who suffer, heavily laden with the weight of my troubles, I cast myself at your feet and humbly beg of you to take the present affair, which I recommend to you, under your special protection. Altogether, please recommend it to your daughter, the Blessed Virgin Mary, and lay it before the throne of Jesus, so that he may bring it to a happy issue. Please continue to intercede for me until my request is granted. Above all, obtain for me the grace of one day beholding my God face to face, and with you and Mary and all the saints, praising and blessing him for all eternity. Amen. Good Saint Anne, mother of her who is our life, our sweetness, and our hope, pray to her for us and obtain our requests. Good Saint Anne, mother of her who is our life, our sweetness, and our hope, pray to her for us and obtain our requests. Good Saint Anne, mother of her who is our life, our sweetness, and our hope, Pray to her for us and obtain our requests. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Good Saint Anne.
Pray for us.
And I would just mention as we begin, I will be offering Mass tonight for Sid Michaels, or Sid Kavulich, as we know him. We all know him from perhaps sports announcing. We know him here at St. Anne's from directing our media ministry and from doing pretty much anything we needed him to do when we asked him to step in and cant for the Mass or read for the Mass or serve for the Mass or be Eucharistic minister for the Mass. Sid was always there for us. So we're going to remember him in a special way tonight.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, we gather in faith this night as we bring to a close this 100th anniversary of the solemn novena to St. Anne. For 100 years, folks like yourself have been coming to this hilltop to pray, to turn to the Lord and trust, and to open their hearts to the power and presence of God. And through God's faithful servants, St. Anne, being the one that we look to these days, we join together as a communion of saints living and gone to the Lord, in and through whom God continues to work. And so with gratitude in our hearts this night for this great gift, let us come before the Lord acknowledging our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us pray. O Lord, God of our fathers, who bestowed on Saints Joachim and Anne this grace, that of them should be born the mother of your incarnate Son, grant through the prayers of both that we may attain the salvation you have promised to your people. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. Now will I praise those godly men, our ancestors, each in his own time. These were godly men whose virtues have not been forgotten. Their wealth remains in their families, their heritage with their descendants. Through God's covenant with them, their family endures, their posterity for their sake. And for all time, their progeny will endure, and their glory will never be blotted out. Their bodies are peacefully laid away, but their name lives on and on. At gatherings, their wisdom is retold, and the assembly proclaims their praise. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God will give him the throne The Lord has chosen Zion for his own home. She is mine, and I will dwell in her. Swore to David, my crown will shine upon you and on your son. God will give him the throne of David, his father.
A reading from the book of James. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister has nothing to wear and has no food for the day, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat well, but you do not give them the necessities of the body, what good is it? So also faith of itself, if it does not have works, is dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Good evening, everybody. What a joy this night is for all of us. Let us praise God for the gift and blessings of this novena for 100 years. It's kind of amazing to stand here and to look out over all of you and you from your vantage point looking at this wonderful, wonderful basilica and monastery. This place, these hallowed grounds on which thousands and thousands of people have gathered for 100 years, just like we do tonight. I know you join me in offering words of gratitude to Father Jim O'Shea, the provincial of the Passionist community, to Father Richard Burke, and the members of the Passionist community here in Scranton, to Father Jim Paisley, the pastor of St. Anne's Parish, as well as to the parishioners, the friends, and the supporters of this wonderful monastery and novena for making this incredible time of prayer and worship available to us all. On your behalf, I especially want to extend our thanks to Fathers Daniel and Father Nelson for preaching this year's 100th novena to St. Anne. You have touched this community deeply, and we are so grateful. A neighbor of yours here in Westside, James Early, wrote a book when he was chancellor of our diocese. It's entitled Envisioning Faith, A History of the Diocese of Scranton. And he recalled these words about this novena. From its inception in 1924, the novena to St. Anne proved to have a significant impact on the entire religious life of the Diocese of Scranton. Crowds descend on the monastery each Monday, and particularly during the solemn novena to St. Anne that concludes on her feast day. He went on to note that during the first year of the novena, 100 years ago, the Passionist Fathers received 3,844 letters of thanksgiving to God for favors granted. Wow. Can you imagine what that number would be today if we compiled those letters and those experiences for 100 years? Countless, countless more prayers have been answered, and innumerable lives have been enriched and sustained, not only within the Diocese of Scranton, but throughout our country and lands throughout the world. And the great gift of faith that has been planted in our hearts and lives by God at baptism has been nurtured and given the grace to grow in ways well beyond our imagining through the ministry of St. Anne's Monastery and the Passionist community. As the theme for this year's novena has reminded us time and again, we are indeed grateful to the Passionist community, and most especially grateful to God for 100 years of blessings. And to the Passionists, and ultimately to our God, we say thank you. Two weeks ago, I returned from a week-long meeting in Lisbon, Portugal, For the last 3 years, I've been privileged to serve as the Vatican's international, as co-chair of the Vatican's International Catholic Pentecostal Dialogue. Typically, on the Sundays, during the week-long meeting that we experience, the members of the dialogue, Catholics and Pentecostals, worship together in the tradition of the group that's hosting that year. This year, with Catholics hosting the gathering in Lisbon, Portugal, as you might imagine, the logical place for our Sunday worship was the shrine of Our Lady of Fatima, just a short distance away. While we gathered for Mass in the great plaza in front of the Basilica, not surprising, and perhaps not unlike this hillside, there were all sorts of devotions that were taking place simultaneously. Mass was being celebrated. People were waiting in line to light candles. Some were praying the rosary. And not a few were prayerfully processing toward the Basilica on their knees. It was one of these individuals who captured the attention of all of us, Catholic and Pentecostal alike, causing us to pause, to reflect, and to pray. You see, we watched a young mother on her knees making that procession for well the distance from here to the bottom of the property of St. Anne's. She was clasping her hands with a rosary in them, and she was cradling at the same time as she moved on her knees ever so slowly her baby, while tears streamed down her cheeks. She spoke no words, and we surely didn't intrude on her time of prayer. Nevertheless, it was clear from the expression on her face that she was suffering greatly, and she was most likely imploring God for the sake of her little baby, who looked frail and in poor health. Imagine, the ground there is just as hard as it is here. We wouldn't want to go on our knees lest we have to have a knee replacement. But there she was, on her knees, on the pavement, moving ever so slowly with a baby in her arms. Our eyes followed her for as long as we could, and we started to pray with her and for whatever her intention might have been. And when we returned to our dialogue meeting later that afternoon, at least for a few minutes, our different backgrounds and religious beliefs faded away as we reflected upon that experience at Fatima. Catholic or Pentecostal, we all acknowledged that what we had witnessed at work in the life of that young mother was nothing short of the power of God. Her faith, authentic and living, compelled her to get on her knees, to hand herself over to God, and to simply trust that through God's mercy and healing grace, He would care for her and her child, come what may. It was a powerful experience. But brothers and sisters, I would suggest that the same stories of faith, the same encounters with God, and the same miracles of God's sustaining grace have been occurring on this hillside for 100 years. Your presence here tonight as well as the presence of thousands others over these past days, is testimony to that reality. Brothers and sisters, recall again the words from this evening's gospel. Blessed are your eyes because they see, and your ears because they hear. In telling the parable, Jesus affirms his disciples for providing an environment of fertile soil for the seeds of faith that God had planted. And he goes on to encourage them in their willingness to announce the kingdom of God, even though he knows, and so do they, that they will undoubtedly do so in the midst of a harsh and disappointing world, that it is adverse to so much of what they believe and proclaim. Their world, as much as its shape and form and experiences, are so different than what we encounter today. The struggles and the pain and the disappointment and the fear and the need to trust God are the same. Our world is difficult and challenging, and you know that every bit as well as I. This land is polarized and filled with voices of hate, rooted in religious and cultural differences. In this modern and sophisticated era, people are still discriminated against because of the color of their skin, the way they speak, the country of origin, their lifestyle, and what they don't have. Immigrant families, the very foundation and lifeblood of this land in which we find ourselves, are being used as pawns to support political ideologies on both sides of the issue. The poorest among us suffer, while the privileged pay little to their needs. And far too many of us grieve losses and suffer due to the consequences of age, illness, and sin. This is not an easy world in which we find ourselves. It will not be fixed with an election. It will not change like that because of a prayer. Because God is here. He's here. He's here in the Eucharist that we celebrate. He's here in the word proclaimed. And he is most especially here in the lives of his faithful people, all of you, in and through whom he is present, offering hope, consolation, and peace. When we are not too proud to journey with one another, to take one another by the hand, figuratively and for so many of you literally, helping us move from place to place, serving one another in our needs, and rejoicing with one another in the goodness and in the power of God. Through the stories of your lives and mine, in our desire to grow in faith, and especially through the liturgy that we share, God is all around us and here on this hilltop, enveloping us with his love and mercy, giving us hope in times of struggle and challenge. As we bring this novena to a close, may we hold within our hearts other words from our Holy Father. Let us follow the path
that the Lord desires. Let us ask him to turn to us with his healing and saving gaze, never allowing ourselves to be tarnished by pessimism or sin. Let us seek and look upon the glory of God, which shines forth in all men and women who are fully alive through faith. And in gratitude, brothers and sisters, let us give thanks for 100 years of blessing. Good Saint Anne, pray for us. Incidentally, my homily was a lot shorter, but Father O'Shea said I needed to add to it, so if it was too long for you. Oh, I think I need to say something now, don't I? See, I got distracted. That's what happens. In faith, let us come before the Lord with our prayers and our hopes.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. For the intentions of all those praying the Novena to Saint Anne, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peaceful resolutions to all conflicts and violence in the world, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick in any way, especially those with chronic illnesses, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the welfare of our commonwealth and of our nation, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Holy Catholic Church, our Holy Father, Pope Francis, and church leaders, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of Bishop Bambara, we pray to the Lord.
Loving Father, hear the many prayers we place before you in faith, for we make them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands. Praise and glory to his name, for our good and the good of all holy church.
Receive, we pray, O Lord, these offerings of our homage, and grant that we may merit a share in the same blessings which you promised to Abraham and his descendants, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For in this marvelous confession of your saints, you make your church fruitful with strength ever new, and offer us sure signs of your love, and that your saving mysteries may be fulfilled. Their great example lends us courage. Their fervent prayers sustain us in all we do. And so, Lord, with all the angels and saints, we too give you thanks, as in exaltation we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an everlasting offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with the blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, with Saint Anne and Joachim, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for their unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth. With your servant Francis, our Pope, me, your unworthy servant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Amen.
Body of Christ here. Christ. The body of 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 Christ.
Let us pray. O God, who willed that your only begotten Son should be born from among humanity, so that by a wonderful mystery
humanity might be born again from you. We pray that in your kindness, you may sanctify by the Spirit of adoption those you have fed with the bread you give your children. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for a few moments, please. I just want to offer some gratitude of my own this night as we conclude our celebration. And I'll start with thanking all those who took part in the committee 4 months ago to help plan our celebration of the 100th anniversary of our solemn novena. They did a tremendous job, and people working in very different dimensions of life brought it all together and made this novena a very beautiful, prayerful, and reverent event. So I want to be grateful to all of them. And I want to say especially thank you to Leo Maxfield and Anthony Chico. Those two young men were responsible for combing through 100 years of history in our archives and putting together a presentation down in the lower basilica, giving us a bird's eye glimpse of what the solemn novena journeyed through all those decades of the past 100 years. It's really quite a marvelous feat, and a very instructive and prayerful feat, and I want to thank them for a great many hours of work putting that all together for us. And I do need to thank generally all the volunteers of St. Anne's Basilica Parish. Liturgical ministers, ushers, staffing the food pavilion down there, and I might add, led by our pastor down at the food pavilion. He provided lunches with a song and a prayer. So it was a very wonderful time for everyone who went down to enjoy a bite to eat. So I want to thank Father Paisley and all those who worked at the food facility. And I also want to thank, of course, all of our liturgical ministers that helped make the novena run so smoothly. That is our lectors, our extraordinary ministers of the Eucharist, our servers, our altar servers, all of them helped to pull together and make our liturgical celebrations very prayerful and very smooth. So we want to thank them all. Now we want to especially thank and before I forget, which I usually do, we want to thank our Knights of Columbus for being here tonight. They're always here to help us out. And I want to thank all, especially our young volunteers who are ushers. These are tremendous young people. And you know, there's some from St. Anne's Basilica Parish. There are many from St. Mary's, Mount Carmel, and Dunmore, and many who are students at Holy Cross High School. So we want to thank them in a special way for being here and being so faithful all 10 days here, morning till night. So I thank them very much. And I have to offer some thanks to our brother diocesan priests who helped us in providing the sacrament of confession in a special way, along with Father Kennedy, who is a newly ordained priest from the Eparchy of Passaic. He found he had a little time in his hands, and I sort of used it up on him. So we're very happy that he joined us in and was able to help with confession. And I want to thank my brother Passionists, who came from around the province to be with us oftentimes during the year. And I especially want to thank our Caribbean Passionists for being here. Our Passionists from Haiti, from Jamaica, West Indies, and from Puerto Rico. I want to thank them in a very special way. And of course, there are many people that helped keep everything running smoothly. Waste management provided the care that we needed to keep things clean and picked up. Our Scranton Police Department, who so wonderfully directed traffic for us and kept us safe. And our Pennsylvania Ambulance Service that was here in case any of us needed them in any way. And we especially, Father Bishop Bambera already thanked our preachers, but I'll do it again. Fathers Nelson and Daniel provided wonderful, thoughtful, prayerful talks for us to think about and take with us. And I do want to thank our provincial, Father Jim O'Shea, for joining us and leading us in prayer tonight, along with Bishop Bambera. I do want to mention three of our devotees who went home to God this year. They were very special to the Novena. The first was Helen Cummings. Helen Cummings was our organist. She was our liturgical musician for over 50 years. And she played the Novena, every Novena, up until she was 90 years old. And then, and had 2 years when she was unable to, but for up to 90 years old, she was playing for us. So we want to welcome her to the Lord God. Along with her was a good friend of hers, Angela Antosha. Angela Antosha was one of our cooks in the monastery. And she did all kinds of volunteer work apart from that. So we want to thank her. And then most recently, only this past week, Richard Leonori. Richard Leonori, I don't even think he was a member of our church, but he was a member of the architectural team of Hemler and Gemeide, who engineered the renovation of the basilica. He designed the way that the sanctuary looks today. And he also designed this outside sanctuary that we're celebrating tonight. And he went home to God after a fight with cancer. So we want to ask the Lord to be good to him too. And we have to thank our neighbors. Our neighbors put life on hold for us for 10 days. They have to rearrange their schedules, their shopping schedules, their work schedules, and find a way to get out without getting stuck in traffic. So they do a lot of accommodating to keep us praying and happy. So we want to thank all of our neighbors. And I would just like to mention two in particular. One is Tommy Wallace. Tommy Wallace is a young man who lives down the street on St. Ann Street. Every Novena, he opens up a lemonade stand for people walking up the hill. And at the end of the Novena, he brings up all the money he got on the lemonade stand and donates it to St. Ann. So a little Tommy Wallace, we want to thank him. And there's also another wonderful woman living just down the street. And she is a parishioner, a very wonderful woman, and she's celebrating her 100th birthday today. Her name is Ann Cummings, and she's celebrating her 100th birthday. So, as far as I know, she's the only person living who has made all 100 novenas. So that's kind of a special treat that the Lord gave us by letting her be here with us for her 100th birthday. So we want to thank her in a special way. And finally, we want to thank Bishop Bambera for being here. And I'm going a little longer so that he doesn't worry about how long his homily was. Okay, so, actually, I found his homily most thought-provoking and very, very reflective. And I deeply appreciate his message to us tonight and his very genuine warmth and presence to us as he leads us in prayer. So thank you, Bishop Bambera, very, very much. And of course, we want to thank God and we want to thank St. Anne for all that they do for us. And we ask them to continue to do that all for us. And we thank all of you, the devotees of St. Anne. We ask that the Lord bless you in every way and give you all that you need to be faithful, loving, and servicing disciples of the Lord in our day and age. So thank you all very much.
Good evening, everybody. Just a word before we go home tonight, certainly echoing all the thanks that Father Richard just offered to all of us, particularly the thanks to Bishop Bambera for his constant presence and partnership and support of St. Anne's and St. Anne's Parish and all that's happening here. So thank you to Bishop Bambera. One thought, 100 years is a very important year. Obviously for Passionists, for the province of St. Paul of the Cross, it's one of the things that probably has endured the longest in our province since its founding, this 100-year novena. And one of the nice things that we maybe take away from tonight is when you celebrate something that's 100 years, no one person can take responsibility for it or take pride in it and say, I did it. It's impossible. And I was walking through the cemetery this afternoon, and the 100 or so Passionists that are there, and the other 100 probably or so, 200 that have lived through here and worked in novenas. And from none of them, the only one that got a monument was John Joseph Endler, who started it. No one else got a monument. They just worked over 100 years, day in and day out, came out, heard confessions, blessed, listened, cried with, laughed with, just like the Passionists of today. None of them can say they did it. They were part of it. They did their part, and they handed it on to the next person. Just like all of you, none of you can say you did it, but you're doing your part, just like your parents did, or your grandparents, or, you know, my mother came here from Carbondale in the 1930s. All of us did our part, and it's a reminder to us maybe that sometimes it's important to remember this is all a great work. And it only works because all of us do our part, whether it's the work of the church, whether it's the work of the world. None of us have to do all of it, but each of us has to do our part. Your faith and your capacity to be here and believe and trust and live through the hardships and the heartaches and the successes, you keep doing it and you hand it on to the next person. In the next generation. And all you give is your witness. And maybe 100 years from now, no one will remember you were here, but you did your part and you handed it on. None of us can say we did it by ourselves, but all of us can say collectively for 100 years, we did it. And it's extraordinary. So thank you to all of you. Thank you to my brother Passionist today and from 1924, and to all of you and to your predecessors since 1924. We did it together. You did it together. Congratulations on 100 years of faith and goodness And let's pray together that what we do tonight will be the seeds for the next 100 years in the continuing story of faith in Scranton. So thank you. God bless and good night.
Lord be with you
and with your spirit.
Blessed be the name of the Lord,
now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God. Through the intercession of good Saint Anne, may Almighty God bless us with continual help of mind and body, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Did awesome.
Thank you very much. Yeah, well, I think you have to come out first. And the things stand like before. So Albert will be able to hear and then you come out first.
No.
You know what, you better talk about it.